Everyone, welcome to another Animation Friday. Apologize that this video has to be uploaded a little later on than usual. Been rather busy this weekend, but I will catch up to today's video of Sunday, so I'll be making three videos today. And I thought it would be interesting to address this particular topic outside since it's such a nice day out, even though it's been a little bit windy. So without further ado, let me discuss my favorite non-Disney female characters. Now, I haven't done really a characters one for this Animation Friday in quite some time, so I thought it would be interesting to, or at least just characters by themselves as opposed to couples. So I thought it would be interesting to dive into this topic in particular. I've noticed with a lot of non-Disney female characters is that there's not really a huge abundant supply of them. They're usually rather kind of rare, I almost want to say, and usually it's hard for me to determine which ones stand out to me the most because they kind of go up on the same sort of level or same sort of playing field. So it's hard to pick the ones that really did stand out to me personally. But I'm going to kind of go through my choices and you are more than welcome to share yours, and feel free to disagree or agree. So the first character I wanted to briefly discuss is Anastasia from the film Anastasia. This is a non-Disney product, and the funny thing is this, a lot of people I think mistake it for Disney actually, and automatically put it in that Disney label because Anastasia is technically royalty, meaning that she is kind of supposed to represent a princess. So I think people, for some reason, put her in that category. Also, I think with the animation style, it looks fairly similar to something that would come out of Disney. So I could kind of understand why people make the mistake when they initially watch the film and they don't see that it's 20th Century Fox before the film starts. What I like about Anastasia in particular as a character, and again, I'm not judging these characters based upon how good the films are, because I think even some of the films that I'm mentioning, they're not the highest quality of animated films. But I'm just judging them based upon the characters that I thought were the most interesting to me. And also this is to take into account somebody's request, because initially they wanted me to kind of address this topic, so I'm going over it now. Anastasia, she is a sort of spunky, very outspoken character. She's interesting in the fact that she kind of has this very, she has kind of the Disney-esque qualities to her character, which I think probably is another reason why people mistake this film in particular for a Disney film. But I like how she is fairly optimistic. She kind of doesn't let, you know, anybody sort of get her down. I like also the fact that she's sort of a team player and she has this sense of determination and wanting to, you know, find out who her family is, which is really the primary focus of the film. So I think she just goes to great lengths, and she also plays an important role in interacting with the other characters, and you sort of see how she kind of develops and evolves as the film goes on. And it's nice too because she's, you know, she's not one of those people who's fairly like self-absorbed or, you know, anything like that. She's just someone just trying to find her family, and then she ends up finding something that she didn't expect. So that's kind of another thing too, is I like it when characters find things sort of unexpectedly. The only controversial thing that I find about this character, in particular with, I think, in regards to the writing choice, there's one point within the film where Anastasia does inflict some sort of violence to another character. In particular, the person who's really supposed to be helping her on her journey, who, again, she felt like what he did was an act of betrayal. And so it would make sense that I think she would react in this kind of way. But I can understand why some people might be off put by it because it was kind of it was kind of very forceful. But then some people will make the argument that the other character was kind of having some force onto her, but he really wasn't all that much when you really look at when you really watch it. Because there's this one scene where she and the other main character, Dimitri, who's supposed to be helping her find her family, basically, she discovers that he lied to her about something. And this plays a really pivotal role into the film. And what I think what ultimately happens is he tries to convince her that, you know, that she's actually that it's actually not a lie that she's really in. She's actually the real person that that the family was looking for. Because within the film, she's royalty, but she forgot that she was royal and she was separated by her family, and then now she goes and tries to find her family. And suddenly, just because of Dimitri's lie, she now thinks that, you know, he just basically brought her along for the ride and for the sake of him getting money, which also plays an important role within the film. But the scene I'm discussing is when he tries to convince her, and he's not really all that forceful. He's just kind of holding onto her hand kind of strongly because he just wants to, you know, explain himself to her. And then, you know, she just storms off, you know, doesn't want to hear anything. But he's trying to, you know, get her to listen to him. But then basically she holds on, he holds on to her at one point, and then she's kind of being forceful back to him. And then, so quasi, she just slaps him in the face. She slaps him pretty hard, too. I mean, he was just doing a little tugging. I mean, she was just like, bam, like in his face. And I thought that was a little bit uncalled for on her part. I mean, again, all she had to do was run. She didn't need to, you know, kind of just sit there and trudge along and be angry. And, you know, she could have just ran if literally. If she literally didn't want to hear anything from him, she didn't have to go and slap him in the face. But she slams him hard. I mean, like, bam, like right in his face. So I thought that was a little bit awkward and a little bit off-putting for her character. And I just felt that was more of like a bad writing choice from the writers as opposed to really her, the true essence of her character. So as a result, I forgive her for that. And I could maybe understand too if she was living beforehand in a very, you know, poor and sort of downtrodden environment that people would probably use physical force more than the average person. So yeah, I just thought that it was just a little bit strange how they chose to literally have a physically violent reaction and not just have her just run or just storm out away, you know, angry or upset, you know, which is totally was justifiable on her part. But again, slapping him in the face, I don't know. But despite that, I still find her character to be rather interesting in that she sort of combines these the sort of traits that we would see in a Disney princess while also still kind of being a little bit more having maybe that kind of spunk that usually DreamWorks Disney or DreamWorks female characters kind of have. So she kind of has this interesting blend going on. And I think it ultimately works to the film's advantage. And it's nice to see her playing off with the other characters, in particular Dimitri, since, you know, they really do have that Pride and Prejudice relationship going on. Which again, something that I don't particularly care for, but I like how they execute it here because it doesn't seem like it's all that. It doesn't really seem like they hate each other. It just seems like they kind of just go back and forth. You know, it's just like a really over-exaggerated kind of relationship at first. So, and I guess that's what makes it comedical and sort of entertaining to watch. So I could understand from that standpoint why they would do that. But ultimately, I think her character is one of the more interesting ones that I could find out of the female characters that are not part of Disney canon. And yeah, I mean, I don't think Anastasia in particular is the strongest work of non-animated Disney films, but I think Anastasia as a character stands out to me personally for a variety of reasons, but I think largely it has to do with, I think, how they blended these two kinds of concepts that were sort of going on within animated female characters. They made her have those typical Disney traits, but then they also inserted a little bit of spunk and, you know, adventurous, they use these sort of adventurous side too that we see in a lot of, I think, more DreamWorks non-Disney canon characters. So I liked how they blended the two, and I thought that really worked, especially if they were trying to make a film that does have a sort of a princess in it. But I think that's ultimately all I can say about that character. Next character that I wanted to briefly talk about is Fiona from the Shrek series. What I like about this character in particular is she's very feisty, but I like how there's really a lot of growth with her character. You really do see how the way she starts off in the first movie is developed and changed over some time within the film. Because initially, again, she wants to be... Initially, at first, she kind of wants to be human again. Like, you can kind of get that sense that she wants to be back to who she was. And then she realizes that, I guess, she's more comfortable being her ogre self. And so she lets that sort of, you know, be ultimately who she ends up being. So I think that's really a way of sort of expressing, like, sort of her self-acceptance. Like, she accepts the fact that she will be in this form and I guess likes that form. But I also think, too, that, again, she plays off the other characters fairly well. She and Shrek just kind of resemble what we would see out of probably a more real-life couple, but in sort of like a kind of comedic way. And I think that's what makes her stand out. She sort of embraces that sort of DreamWorks-type female character. Whereas Anastasia, again, is more of a blend between Disney and non-Disney. Fiona is pure DreamWorks material, because usually you'll notice this, though. It's pretty much standard animation 101. DreamWorks female characters are a little bit more spunky. They're a little bit more maybe non-traditional, so to speak. And they just have a lot of energy. They're not as maybe calm and smooth and delicate. They have little edges to them. And I think Fiona sort of embraced that. You'll sort of see that throughout her journeys within the Shrek films. Would recommend the first two, not the third and fourth one, really. Even though I haven't seen the fourth one, apparently there was just kind of like a mixed feeling, as opposed to the first two, where a lot of people, generally speaking, seem to enjoy the first two. So, but I like her for the fact that she sort of embraces that sort of DreamWorks style. It's fun. It's nice to see, and it's enjoyable to watch. So I guess I could say she's not only one of the more non-traditional, she's one of the more entertaining, I guess you could say, out of the non-traditional, more DreamWorks style female characters. Now, the third one that I wanted to discuss is one that I don't think usually people automatically think of when they think of the non-Disney female characters. That is Emily from Corpse Bride. This was actually made by Warner Brothers, apparently. So it's not Disney. it's not associated with Disney, unlike The Nightmare Before Christmas, even though I think it's under Touchstone, but I think Touchstone is owned by Disney, and that's why Disney can make a a Nightmare Before Christmas ride in their park every year when there's Halloween and Christmas. Of course, Brad, that is not the case. But Emily basically is the Corpse Bride within the film Corpse Bride. And what I like about her character, she has this sort of innocence to her, even though there is this, like, very, you know, dark, creepy appearance to her, because, again, she is a corpse. So I think that that was something that was kind of refreshing. It's like, ooh, there's this person that looks very deformed, but at the same time, she has this very kind and innocent nature to her. And also charisma, another big thing. And what I like, too, is how they sort of, again, the way they develop this character, I think, is really good. Because at first she starts off not really knowing, you know, what really happened to her, because you see within the film how she was ultimately killed. And then when she becomes a corpse, she doesn't really know who killed her, and she sort of trying to figure out that kind of past. Even though she, again, initially has that initial desire to get married, because once she literally wakes up, the other main character in this film, who's played by Johnny Depp, you know, is sort of, not really, I guess we could say, sort of forced into marrying her. And so she initially sees as the marriage is the most important thing for her to find, because that was sort of taken from her when she died. And then she ultimately realizes who really killed her and why. So there's this, like, huge kind of growth pattern that she takes, where there's one point where she's largely focused on trying to obtain that love that she initially wanted out of life, but then sort of she realizes that that it's important for her to ultimately find out who was trying to harm her and who was trying to create some kind of who was basically just kind of just trying to ruin her life for the most part, all for the sake of money. And you'll sort of see the who that person ultimately ends up being if you choose to watch the film. But again, I sort of like that sort of transition that she has, and then she kind of grows to accept the Johnny Depp's character's decision to ultimately wed somebody else. And I think she's just one of those enjoyable characters to watch, and she's very engaging. And on the one hand, I do think personally that her and Johnny Depp's character had a lot more chemistry. I kind of understand, though, why ultimately things wouldn't work out, because it's just not logical. I mean, she's dead, and she's not gonna be coming alive again, and so she's on a different path and a different stage. So, again, it's just one of those films that's very interesting, and I liked how they... And it was just an enjoyable and interesting character to watch. She just had this very nice approach to her, and she ultimately ends up discovering more of who ultimately she is, and ultimately realizes that maybe the living's happiness is more important maybe than hers, since she's already dead and doesn't have any more life anymore. So again, there's just a lot going on with her, and I think that it was very interesting how the film expressed that. So, again, enjoyable film. Is Corpse Bride maybe on the top 10 best animated films of all time? No, but I think definitely as far as a non-Disney character that is female goes, I think she worked out really fine. Fourth one, and second to last one, Shell from The Road to El Dorado. Yeah, this one is a lot more on the Fiona side, as you can probably tell. The thing about Shell, though, is she has this kind of really kind of more seductive quality to her than Fiona does. She has maybe this, she has more maybe of this attitude too. Like, she's just a little bit more sassy, I think. Fiona's more feisty, like, she'll, you know, when she thinks something is annoying or something bothers her, you know, she'll just take the rage out on it. Whereas with Shell, she just kind of has this very seductive, you know, just really sassy attitude about things. And it's not to say anything in the negative sense, so much as in the positive sense, because that's what makes her really entertaining and fun to watch. What I like too is the fact that she ends up helping out the con men that are within the film, who are actually our main protagonists. And what I like about that is usually you don't see characters, even female characters, really going along with such kind of a scheme. Like, you know, usually the female character would probably tell somebody and be like, yep, these two are frauds. But she totally goes along with it, totally plays with it, and really does help these two con men like understand her cult, her people's culture, because again, they end up going to El Dorado, which is like a place where there's lots of gold, and you know, it's like this. I almost want to say it might be Aztec. I could be wrong, but it's some kind of South American culture that supposedly no longer exists, but during that time period, apparently, there was some speculate, or well, really in the 1500s, they still had people from those cultures that still existed. It's just apparently that there was a lot of myth surrounding, you know, that culture having a lot of wealth and you know, minerals and things like that, like gold, you know. So, but basically, she just helps these guys out, like, no problem. She's like, yeah, okay, I'll help you out. No issues there. And she just kind of helps them along the way into understanding her culture so that they can play up the con and basically, you know, continue to, you know, live in their lifestyle that they are in when they're in her, basically her people's land or whatnot, or their culture. Because basically the con is that they pretend to be gods. And she clearly knows that they're not gods, but she totally plays along with it. I find it hilarious because nobody else in the entire city apparently questions them, except she just knows right away, and I find that very, very funny and interesting. And again, she has her own self motivations. Can she be a little bit, maybe a little bit more on the sleazy side at times? Yeah, especially for like a kid's film, I can understand why some people would be like, you know, she's just pushing it maybe a little bit too hard. But I think that just makes her all the more kind of human. I think she really ultimately works as a character. She has that attitude, she has this wit about her, and you know, she's willing to play along with their con. And usually you don't see characters really do that. You don't even see female characters even do that. So I thought it was funny, and I think it ultimately worked. Is Road to El Dorado really all that great of a film? Probably not really. There are a lot of genuinely little funny moments in there, but again, as overall as a film, it's not going to be in the top animated films of all time. But her character, as far as a non-Disney character is concerned, I think ultimately really works to the film's advantage. Even though, again, I can understand if some people might be like, she's not as kid-friendly. Again, was Jessica Rabbit really all that kid-friendly too, you know? I would say Shell's probably the Who Framed Roger, she's like the Jessica Rabbit of DreamWorks, maybe. Except she doesn't sing, at least, but she, you know, she has that, like, seductive ness to her that is sort of upped within the film that you usually don't see in a lot of kid films. But I guess they get that, again, that's kind of what makes it refreshing, and that's what's fun to sort of watch, or why she's sort of fun to watch. But that's all I think I can say about her. Last film is from How to Train Your Dragon, Astrid Hofferson. In case you're not sure which character that is, that's the girl with the side ponytail. At first, I think she keeps it in the back in the first film, and then in the second film, she has it on the side. But I'm still going to call the fact that she invented it, and that Elsa from Frozen probably took that idea. It wouldn't surprise me, considering the fact that she's also sort of Nordish, and she's supposed to be a Viking within How to Train Your Dragon for Astrid. So yeah, I think it only makes sense that Disney probably pulled some design ideas from there. And she has blonde hair. Elsa has blonde hair. But regardless of who invented the side ponytail, or the pony braid, really, I like how this film, again, I like how this character is kind of developed. First, she sort of starts off as this very bratty, kind of one of the guy's female characters. You know, that the typical bratty, you know, tomboy girl, which some people can find annoying or, which can be kind of annoying or either charming. I think it was funny at times because I think it only makes sense that we would see, is, and again, she's a lot younger then, so I think it only makes sense that she would have that kind of bratty nature to her and how she's just trying to, you know, she's just trying to, again, impress these other people that are within her group and sort of try to make herself to be out to be the leader, and just kind of be bratty, and that's usually how female characters operate when they're trying to assert their authority, kind of like in Peanuts, again, where Lucy is causing all these problems and being a real pain in the butt. That's kind of how Astrid goes off to be in the first film, parts of the first film. But again, you see sort of her development, and then once she's kind of introduced to the dragon and everything, you know, and she kind of, I think, softens up a bit. And then eventually within the second How to Train Your Dragon film, she's kind of a little bit more mature, and she handles situations a lot more maturely than she did in the first film. So again, there's this growth of her, you know, she starts off as a brat, and then she kind of starts off to be more developed and more fully fleshed out into the more fully fleshed out female character. So yeah, I thought she was a lot of fun too. She has her moments of brattiness, but again, fun to watch, entertaining. But again, she sort of fits that typical mold though of DreamWorks. So it only makes sense that we would see these kinds of female characters within non-Disney films. But I think that's ultimately all I can say when it comes to this video on this particular topic. Yeah, if there are any questions, comments, concerns, I'd be more than happy to answer them. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you all have a pleasant day, week, month, and year, and I hope to see you all in the next video. Take care. Bye-bye.